It's time for the Spoony One Wrestling Show. It's time for the Spoony One Wrestling Show.
We are back with our review of WrestleMania and in some ways the NXT TakeOver show in Dallas. This is a complex one to review. I already took heat about my live Twitter recaps about this show. I believe this is firmly in the lower tier of WrestleManias. Not the worst. I'd have to watch the other ones that are considered the worst, like 9 and stuff like that. But the reason that this one is so bad is not because, like, as a self-contained show, it was horrible. The wrestling was average to below average. Mm-hmm. What really sets this one down is, this is probably the whole recap, is, for one, it's like the culmination of, like, an entire years of shitty booking.
Yeah.
You know, having learned nothing.
Yeah.
Over the year, the course of...
Not a thing.
You know, listening to the crowd and stuff like that. They had their chance at Roadblock to just abort this whole thing. It would have been kind of crappy writing, but at least the fans would have been a little happier than the main event that we got, which was universally shat upon. The second was the... Less than the booking... less than the wrestling is the booking. Terrible. Top to bottom.
Really, really bad.
Top to bottom, just horrible decisions on who goes over. Right? So, taken in its entirety, as kind of a summation of the year, my God, this was
a bad
show.
It's a summation of a bad year, so I'm not surprised that it came out to be a bad WrestleMania, but...
What really dragged it down was the fact that this came 2 days after the NXT TakeOver show.
Yeah.
Which was an amazing show.
Which was really good.
And we knew at the time, just in advance, that this was never going to hold up compared to NXT.
We should stop watching NXT before we watch WrestleManias and Raws and stuff.
We should watch nothing but NXT.
Then we'd have a very good and cheerful review show.
Yeah, right. But I liked every single match on the NXT show. Every single one than any match on WrestleMania. And I'm going to take heat for that one, too. I stand by it. But, yeah, it really got eclipsed. You know, there was no way it was going to hold up at all. My perception of the show is also colored by a couple matches in particular that legitimately made me angry. But we'll get to that. I have a list of the matches because I've already forgotten some of the things that happened. In fact, I still have no memory of one match in particular. The pre-show consisted of Kalisto versus the Ryback for the U.S. Championship.
It was okay.
It was a good match.
Yeah.
It was every basic Raw match you've ever seen the Ryback in.
Yeah.
Here's the
problem. I actually think the Ryback has been improving lately.
Yes.
He seems to be wrestling better.
Yeah.
So I liked this match.
This was probably booking at its most basic. Mean big guy versus plucky little guy.
Yeah.
Contrary to form, the little guy won this time, so this was a good match. Here's the problem. Nobody gives a shit about Kalisto.
I give a shit about Kalisto.
So do I. But the crowd was just
the
like...
The crowd was kind of quiet, but it was also during the part of the pre-show where people still hadn't gotten in the building.
Yeah, apparently there was big problems people getting into the building.
So you could just look and see empty seats everywhere.
I don't think that cost the match, though. People just... Since he won the title, have not given a crap about the guy, which is weird because he's been booked pretty strong. He's gone over Alberto Del Rio a lot. But for some reason...
Do you think it's just because they prefer the partnership of him and Sin Cara?
No. I don't know why. I have no clue, really.
Because he's a good wrestler. I like watching him. He's entertaining.
I do know one reason. Is because Bradshaw consistently buries the little fucker.
Yeah.
Even when he wins, like, Bradshaw's like, yeah, but he's still small. Like, calling him a mosquito constantly. Yeah. Even as he's beating Alberto clean, like, 3 times. He's like, yeah, but he's still tiny. And I'm like, what the...
That's the voice of Vince in his ear.
Yeah, I know he's a heel, but what the fuck, man? You just can't let it go. This was a good match. It was fine. I may have the order a little out of order here. The Total Divas versus Bad and Blonde 10 Divas tag match.
Oh, that one was...
For no reason.
Yeah.
Like, all of a sudden we care about Total Divas again. Like, they've all banded together. What was really funny going into this was Eva Marie, who debuted on the Raw previous week as the surprise mystery partner on Total Divas. And I just know that they were expecting Eva Marie, Vince was expecting Eva Marie to be this huge conquering baby face, be hugely popular because she's hot as hell. And that's all dudes care about, obviously.
Yeah, that's all he thinks, anyway.
Except she sucks. She sucks hard.
She's not a good wrestler at all.
The thing about this match, I thought this match was going to be given 2 minutes, tops, and, like, give Lana, like, give Brie Bella the pin over Lana. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of kind of little idiosyncrasies about this match, but it was given some time. Mm-hmm. Eva Marie tagged in for about 30 seconds, and she was fine.
Yeah, she did better than I've usually seen her. I mean, she hit her moves correctly and then left.
She had two moves.
Expect from her.
Sorry, she had two moves, like a flying head scissors and the sliced bread number two, which, you know, honestly, she surpasses my expectations as long as the both people in the ring don't burst into flames.
Yeah,
but she did fine. She got booed like crazy, but they kept her out of the match for the most part. Everyone got like 30 seconds to shine. Mm-hmm. And Brie Bella tapped out Naomi with the yes lock. I reckon this could actually be Brie Bella's last match, but that's just me guessing. She wants to retire and have babies. Little bearded babies.
Little bearded babies. they come out with beards and flannel on, already vegan.
Yeah, so the Total Divas won, and this really settles all sorts of things in the world. I feel like something was really accomplished. Yeah, the Usos versus the Dudley Boys.
I didn't care for this match very much.
This was fine.
It was just a Raw match.
Yeah, this match worked fine. They have dropped the entire idea of the Dudleys vowing never to use tables again.
Yeah.
They dropped that immediately. I know they're...
Now they're using even more tables.
Yeah, I mean, they're heels and they're hypocrites, I know that, but the thing is, they're not even making a thing. Like,
yeah.
For one week they came out...
For this, they know what the people want.
Yeah.
Tables.
The Usos got booed. Mm-hmm. Because they wanted to see tables, and they want to see the Dudleys use the tables, and they got... Yeah. It was actually a really cool moment. I thought the Usos doing the double frog splashes through the tables. It was fine. It was a good match. That's about all I have to say about it. The Usos win, and then the New Day versus the League of Nations. Oh, boy.
I didn't see this one. I think I...
Yeah, I saved you from this one.
I got tired or got disgusted and left.
Yeah, the New Day remains probably the most over baby faces in the company. Well, until Raw. There was a lot of cool debuts on Raw. They had a really awesome entrance emerging from a box of Bootios, dressed like Saiyans.
Super Saiyans, yeah.
It was probably one of the high points of the show, actually.
It was all Xavier Woods' idea.
Oh, yeah. Well, Kofi, whatever. But, you know, the Bootios thing, I don't get. I guess I'm too booty, but...
You're just too white.
They had giant Bootios in the box, and they emerged from the box, and they still carry around a Bootio. I would not eat a cereal with the word booty in it, even if it makes sure you ain't booty. This is more entertaining than the match itself, this lame dialogue I'm spewing on you. This was not for the tag team championships. They were not defended on WrestleMania.
No.
Instead, they changed the match like up to literally the last minute. You know, this was going to be a tag team championship match. Then it was going to be a 4-on-3 handicap match. Hmm. The league for quote unquote tag team supremacy, mm-hmm. which I thought that's what the titles were for.
Yeah, you'd think.
Now it was a 3-on-3 match, again, not for the tag titles.
So it changes nothing.
Changes nothing, and then on Raw, the New Day just basically conquered the League of Nations in a normal tag match for the titles. The end of which is they kicked Wade Barrett out of the league. I think Wade is... King Barrett is done with the company. Mm. He asked for his release. It was a good match. As far as it goes, the League of Nations is the biggest job squad in the company. They ought to be feuding with the Social Outcasts for the bottom of the totem pole.
They should.
From what I understand, in dark matches, Bo Dallas is getting cheered over Kalisto.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Not good.
Not good.
Bo Dallas looks like such a weird, like, he looks like a half-finished clone.
He needs to be put back in the oven for a little while.
He looks so pale and doughy, and he's got this weird face.
He does have a weird face.
He looks like kind of the attractive brother of Sloth from the Goonies.
That's mean.
He's ugly as shit, man.
He just looks like a big, giant man baby, that's all.
At least they stopped, they put him in a singlet and not the man diaper.
The man diaper.
Never wear white tights, wrestlers.
Never wear white underwear.
Just straight up.
Like you're wearing just your tidy whities or a diaper.
Yeah, anyway, I've been over that. The League of Nations won. Yes, they won because King Barrett was outside, hit him with a bull hammer, and that was it. Then Here's where things, I immediately kind of checked out on this show. League of Nations gets in the ring. They're gloating about winning. And they say, there's no three men in the company who can stand up to the League of Nations, even though there's four of them.
Mm-hmm.
Then Shawn Michaels comes out, looking pretty good, actually. Then Mick Foley comes out, and then Stone Cold Steve Austin comes out. And like, you know, the three men who can stand up to them. They whip the shit out of the League of Nations. You know, they all hit their finishers. Austin stunners the shit out of them. New Day comes in, and they're, like, celebrating. Austin is, like, they all start dancing, and Austin kind of teases like he's going to dance, and then just stuns Xavier Woods. Rusev took an awesome stunner. Okay, this was probably the best feel-good moment of the show, but it was so stupid. It was like you essentially crushed the two top factions in the tag team division.
Mm-hmm.
You had Austin just stun the shit out of all of them,
mm-hmm.
which is what he does. The thing is, like, wow, what joke? You just had the League of Nations beat the New Day, the tag team champions, and then you had Austin and Shawn Michaels and Mick Foley
beat them,
just eradicate them.
Yeah,
like they were nothing. This is going to be a pattern in this show, which.
Not a good pattern either. A very bad pattern.
So this was an example where it was a good match, and then the booking was just, you put the league over?
Mm-hmm.
What?
Why?
Why?
They didn't need it.
Of course they didn't need it, but then, of course, on Raw, the New Day just cleans house.
Yeah.
Just, and it's not, it really wasn't even close. They, you know, beat the shit out of them.
As it tends to be with Raw, like, after WrestleMania, it always just seems to set things right back to status quo.
I don't think that was the case here, but they did undo a lot on Raw.
Yeah.
We'll get to that. Here's where the order I have gets out of whack. AJ Styles versus Chris Jericho. This match. Wow.
I can barely remember it now.
You remember what made you mad.
Yeah.
This was a really not a very good match.
No, it wasn't. I was very surprised by how not good it was and how not impressed I was.
It was by far the weakest of the matches they've had, and I don't know why. It seemed like
they were both tired or something.
It seemed like 4 minutes in, both of them just
winded.
They blew up, and they were still doing kind of impressive things for having blown up.
Mm-hmm.
But it was obvious early on that these two were gassed.
Yeah.
They pulled a good match out considering, but the best I can say it was okay.
Yeah, it was a decent, but not great.
And then Chris Jericho wins clean.
Yeah. Why?
Why? What the...
Again, he didn't need it. Why would you have Chris Jericho, of all people, win and then bury AJ Styles?
It doesn't... Yeah, it buries him.
It buries him. Like, why are you even hiring new people to the company if you're just going to bury them all?
Well, again, this is undone on Raw. You're right about Raw. But yeah, the thing... This entire feud is like... One of the most basic feuds ever, where, you know, they 50-50 book, and then
mm-hmm.
Chris Jericho's role essentially is to put over new talent.
Yeah, but that's not what they're using him for. It's like he's got something in his contract that says, you know, I'm only going to do this if you make sure I win half the time.
No, this isn't Chris Jericho's fault.
I don't think it is. I'm just saying that's what it seems like.
No, but this makes no sense.
No.
The entire point of this feud is that AJ Styles wins.
Yeah.
This served no purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Especially, oh my god. This is where the wheels came off this show. Oh, you know what? Actually, the match before this might have been the Intercontinental title match.
You know what
it was?
Yeah.
That was where the wheels came off the show, which is a bummer because it was the second match on the show.
Yeah.
Here's what my notes read on this match. I was trying to make a list of all the matches so I didn't forget. Of course, I got the order wrong, but whatever. I said it has Kevin Owens versus Sin Cara versus Stardust versus Zack Ryder versus Sami Zayn versus The Miz versus question marks. It was a 7-man tag, and I still cannot remember the 7th man.
Yeah, I don't either.
Do I care enough?
Who else was in that match? We'd have to look it up.
Do I care enough to look it up? No. This was probably the best match on the show, just in terms of what the match was like.
Mm-hmm. Like wrestling terms.
Yeah, it was better than I expected.
Yeah.
But I knew these guys were going to bust their ass for WrestleMania.
Yeah.
You know, they were going to put on a good match one way or the other. Who was the 7th guy?
I can't remember.
Oh, God.
Let me see your list again.
My handwriting is terrible, but
it is.
But they put on a good match, and then Zack Ryder wins. Why?
Yeah.
It got a huge pop from the audience.
The audience was pleased, to my surprise. Do people like Zack Ryder? Is that
yes,
a thing now?
People like Zack Ryder. They like him a lot. And on Raw, they chanted, "You deserve it."
Yeah.
He deserves my ass. He doesn't deserve it. He's kind of, he had a cult following, a much bigger cult following back when he was like starting out.
Mm-hmm.
They were chanting, "Push Zack Ryder" and stuff like that.
Sure.
But what people don't remember is that sometimes they get exactly what they want. They gave Zack Ryder a push.
Mm-hmm.
And then they wish they hadn't asked for it.
Yeah.
Because he's decidedly okay. That's what he is.
Firmly mediocre.
Yeah. He's okay. And that's really not what they wanted. He's almost like Damian Sandow in that way.
Mm-hmm.
Damian Sandow has more of an upside if they'd ever do anything with him. Mm-hmm. I was amazed he showed up on the show.
I was amazed too.
But yeah,
was he the one in the match?
He was in He was in the Battle Royal.
Oh, he was in the Battle Royal. Yeah.
But yeah, Zack Ryder. It was a long time ago, but yeah, they got exactly when they wanted from a Zack Ryder push, and then
nobody wanted it anymore.
Yeah, he put on okay matches, but mm-hmm. People expected like when he finally got his chance, like he was gonna run away. You know, he was gonna take the ball and run with it. No, not really.
Mm.
He's okay, but this blew my mind. Because it was pretty obvious that he was there to replace Neville, mm-hmm. who was very, very tragically injured. Hopefully, it looked pretty bad.
Mm.
I think he broke his leg.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
That sucks. I like Neville a lot, so I'm really disappointed by that.
This just seemed like we're going to do something that nobody would predict. You know, nobody would have called this. And sure enough.
Except, again, it was just someone who didn't need it, other people did.
Well, after this, I was like, well, okay, Zack Ryder's going to go on a 2-year undefeated streak and become the greatest Intercontinental Champion of all time.
Maybe.
I was not correct about this. No, not maybe, no.
Oh, yeah, you're right, no.
Because on Raw...
On Raw, he just loses it again.
He goes out there and he's thanking everybody. And he's
thanking his early dad.
He thanks Pappy Ryder, who, by the way, has guns on him, man.
Yeah, talk about gun show.
This old guy was pretty cool on the show. He goes out there and he's thanking everybody. He's, you know... doing a very good promo about this,
mm-hmm.
you know, and then The Miz comes out and taunts him and says shit about his dad.
Mm-hmm.
And then this was my favorite part of Raw.
I think this is where I got disgusted and left again.
Yeah, you did. He taunts Zack Ryder into giving him a match for
that,
the title.
That part I saw.
Right.
I didn't see the match itself though, because I got disgusted.
But let me do this here. So he's saying shit about his dad and saying shit about how he's going to be a disappointment. You're going to be, you know, you're going to run away from a fight just like I, you know, you're just, you're all hype. That's mm-hmm. what he said. And so this is what Zack Ryder says to him. Woo, woo, woo. Let's do it. Okay. If you challenge me to a fight, any one of you, you know, like, you know, I'm going to kick your ass. Let's take this outside or whatever like that. You know, you came at me. You were going to challenge me to a fight. And my response was, woo, woo, woo. Let's do this. It is impossible to make the words woo, woo, woo intimidating.
Yeah. It's like, never mind, I don't feel it anymore.
I laughed.
I don't want to fight you anymore.
It makes you pitiful. I laughed so hard when you, woo, woo, woo. And then, The Miz and him are having an okay match, and Miz starts talking smack to Pappy Ryder.
Mm-hmm.
And he pushes his dad, and he pushes him back, and he falls on his ass. And then, The Miz's wife, Maryse, looking smoking hot, by the way. She's always looked good. Comes over and slaps Pappy Ryder.
Mm-hmm.
This distracts Zack, and Miz rolls him up for the win and the title. So he has less than a 24-hour championship reign. So that makes the entire ladder match entirely worth it.
Yeah.
You know, at the very least, you know, the fans were going like, you deserve it. You know, you're going to have this run with the title. Oh.
Yeah, you'd think just hearing that, they'd be like, let's change plans real quick and make him keep the title for at least a week.
Well, I mean, anytime, 24 hours after Raw, I was, wow.
It's not the first time I've seen this happen, though.
No, it's not the first,
it's just as stupid every time, though.
They did the same thing with Kalisto, actually.
Did they?
Yeah, when Kalisto won the title, Alberto just beat him right off the bat, and then Kalisto beat him on SmackDown, like, the very next night. So it kind of bounced between the two. But in the end, Kalisto won clean, like, twice, three times in a row. Mm-hmm. So it's settled. But woo, woo, woo. Oh, my God. They should have had Mojo Rawley, like, come out and turn heel on him. Like, you didn't thank me in your promo. What up, bro? That was his big retort to The Miz. You know, he's complaining about how he lost. It sucks to be you, bro. God, I hate Zack Ryder. I hate him good.
You hate his beard, too.
I hate his beard. He looks like such a dork.
I think his beard looks better than the rest of his face, so.
Oh, God. He's all orange, and he's got a stupid beard. And then Dean Ambrose and Brock Lesnar. This!
This was a thing that happened.
I don't even know how to approach this match. The story is that Dean Ambrose is an idiot.
Yeah, that's the story. That's basically it.
He picked a fight with Brock Lesnar.
Because he's an idiot.
Because he's stupid. And he's crazy. Which they remind us of constantly.
Yeah.
And God bless Paul Heyman. He actually did his best to make it seem like Dean Ambrose was a threat. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, there's good wrestlers and there's tough guys. And then there's guys who are crazy. Mm-hmm. Like, you don't want to fight a crazy guy. Mm-hmm. You know, he'll fight till he's hamburger. He'll come at you, you know, you could rip his arm off, but he's fucking crazy.
Yeah.
You know, and Brock's never rarely faced a fucking crazy guy.
Yeah.
And so when you give a fucking crazy guy weapons, everything changes. You know, Paul Heyman was actually doing a hell of a job talking this up. Mm-hmm. You know, but he's still, you know, Brock Lesnar, he doesn't need weapons. He's got, yeah. You know, he's got his mitts. Mm-hmm. So, but he says, like, you know, nobody else is crazy enough to take Brock Lesnar. I admire that. He's still going to kill you, but, you know, introducing a crazy man with weapons, that changes everything. But here's the problem. Here's a problem. One, you have a babyface who, since he cannot compete physically with Brock Lesnar, needs to use weapons.
Yeah.
Brock Lesnar, during the entire match, not only does not use weapons, he gets the weapon and visibly, deliberately rejects the weapon.
Yeah.
Or breaks it.
Breaks it over his knee.
Or gives him the weapon, mm-hmm. and then takes it away from him, mm-hmm. and shoves it up his ass.
Yeah.
This entire match, at no point was it believable in anyone's mind. Like, people wanted Dean Ambrose to win, but, you know, when asked how, you're like, I don't know.
Yeah. Ketchup.
Because, yeah, he should have brought some condiments.
Blind him with the mustard.
But this entire, the entire build up to this was Dean Ambrose would call Brock out, call him out in the ring, mm-hmm. like call him a pussy and come out. And then Brock Lesnar would come out, take the weapon away from him, and then F5 the shit out of him.
Yeah.
And then Dean would be like, was that supposed to hurt? And he'd be like, oh, really? Come back, F5 the shit out of him. Mm-hmm. He beat the shit out of him in fair fights, left and right. Mm-hmm. At no point, except one point, Dean Ambrose got the edge on him, and he hit him in the balls from behind, and then ran away.
Yeah.
And he required Roman Reigns' distraction to hit him in the balls. At no point did anyone seriously believe, like, in character, in storyline, that Dean Ambrose had any shot at winning this. I went on record saying, like, if this is true to booking, Brock should eat this man in 20 seconds.
Yeah.
He probably could have.
Oh, yeah.
But, yeah, it was the only heelish thing that Brock was really doing was kind of toying with him.
Yeah, which is more like what Brock Lesnar's do in the wild anyway.
Yeah.
So
they,
you can't blame him for that. That's just, you know, he sees motion, he bats at it.
Well, actually, I was going to say it, but they may have mentioned that, like, Brock was toying with him, like, with a cat with a dead mouse. They may have said that.
Did they?
If not, I'm taking credit for it. But, yeah, that whole match was, he used every weapon he could find, mm-hmm. and he got his ass kicked and pinned.
Yeah. Pinned clean.
Pinned clean as one can in a street fight. Didn't require Paul Heyman's help.
No.
This
didn't require any weapons. Didn't cheat at all.
He didn't cheat. Well, you can't, but he didn't require any weapons. So the story is...
You can't cheat in a street fight because it's no DQs. But
right.
But he didn't do anything that you could have been DQ'd
dastardly,
for.
Dastardly. No, not
he
really.
He just fought.
So the story of this, in the end, was that Dean Ambrose, given his choice of match, given his choice of weaponry, including a chainsaw...
And a bat with razor wire around it.
A chainsaw...
Which he attempted
to use. He had access to the chainsaw, which he was going to use.
Yeah.
We almost saw a legitimate murder.
Yeah, we almost saw somebody get chainsawed in half.
Had Brock not taken that chainsaw away from him, was his plan to murder Brock Lesnar with a chainsaw?
I think that the chainsaw would just spark off his abs.
But like, in his mind, like in the character, in Dean, the Ambrose, character Dean Ambrose, in his mind, yeah. He was going to hack this man.
And chainsaw his head off.
He was going to hack this man in twain. With a chainsaw.
At least his balls. He's then, like going for the balls.
And then act surprised when the police arrest him for premeditated murder.
Yeah.
There's no DQs! What the fuck? This kind of is like that smart-ass response to every time there's a no DQ match where we go, well, why doesn't he just bring a grenade launcher? He brought a chainsaw!
Yeah.
So the story is, he had access to any weapon he wanted, including something he meant to kill this man with, mm-hmm. and he still failed!
Yeah. Good job, Dean.
He had everything to his advantage, and so he's stupid, he's crazy, and he sucks!
And he lost.
See, the thing is, there's stupid, crazy men mm-hmm. in the history of the WWF who were still awesome. The Ultimate Warrior was a stupid, crazy man. But he beat everybody. Mm-hmm. Because he was awesome.
Yeah.
But Dean Ambrose, they're like, well, they're going to put him over like he's a stupid, crazy man, but he's awesome. But he lost!
Yeah. And he loses pretty frequently. So.
I cannot remember any feud that he has come out on top.
No.
The Wyatts.
Did the Wyatts win when he was feuding with Bray Wyatt?
Yeah. The Wyatts.
Yeah, they did.
John Cena, Dean Ambrose. Not Dean Ambrose.
Dean Ambrose himself. He still loses.
The mirror match, he would. You know, Triple H, he's failed constantly. So the crowd is like, we want to love this guy, but we've given up.
I've given up. I tried to like him, but...
I do like him. I know I don't. I like him, but the thing is, I would like him a lot better if he was winning.
Winning, yeah. I'd like everybody I like a lot better if they were winning, but they only win about half the time, so...
So here's where a pattern starts setting in.
Although, ultimately, I will say about that match, I was satisfied with the conclusion. I just wanted Brock to win.
It was about the only... Yeah.
I would have been mad if he hadn't won.
Here's the pattern. League of Nations, Chris Jericho, Brock Lesnar. I guess Zack Ryder. All heels, except for Zack Ryder.
Yeah.
Who's a dick. And I don't like him. Heels won virtually every match. Then we get to Charlotte versus Becky Lynch versus Sasha Banks for the women's championship. No longer the butterfly belt.
Yeah, now it's actually somewhat dignified.
Probably, if not the best match on the show, second best. That being said, this was just an okay match.
Yeah, it was...
It was good.
I liked it. I thought it was good.
It was good, but nowhere near what they were... I've seen so much better from these.
I've seen better from them.
This was a really sloppy match.
There were some mistakes, and then, of course, Becky got popped in the eye.
Yeah, Becky got a black eye, early on.
Really early on. We thought it was her makeup running, but no, I was pretty sure that she had got hit in the eye.
I never
saw it happen, though.
No, I don't know when it happened. Sasha Banks went for the bank statement, twice, and she fucked it up both times. Mm-hmm. This wasn't a bad match. Don't get me wrong. On a curve, again, probably the best match, but not a really good match. Mm-hmm. I'm going to take so much heat for this one. I don't care. I'm giving it credit and then I'm taking it away, you know.
It's a good match, but when you know that people can do better...
It was not a great match. And then Charlotte wins. Now, in a way, I don't really have a problem with Charlotte winning. Mm-hmm. But it's another heel.
Yeah.
At some point, you got to give the fans something.
Yeah.
Really, at WrestleMania is where the good guys are supposed to win.
Yeah, that's my feeling anyway. That's when the heroes finally get their comeuppance.
Now this is
you know what I mean.
It's the big show. You know, it's the big show where so many feuds are culminated, and the good guys are kind of supposed to win most of the time.
Yeah.
Everyone wanted to see Sasha Banks win.
Yeah.
I think you want to see Becky Lynch win, but...
I wanted to see Becky Lynch win because she never does.
But... Yeah. You will be cured of this. You hope will...
It'll evaporate soon enough.
Yeah.
Like everything else.
But Sasha Banks was put over like such a star. Mm-hmm. You know, she had Snoop Dogg.
Snoop Dogg, Walker, too. I did not know they were cousins, by the way.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
You know, they were putting over the fact that she was wearing an outfit in tribute to Eddie Guerrero.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they were putting over like such a huge star, and then she lost.
Yeah.
Well, she didn't, Becky Lynch tapped out, but she didn't win the match.
Yeah.
And it's so frustrating because at this match, it's just heel after heel after heel. And Zack Ryder winning.
Yeah.
It's just this huge list of disappointments.
Yeah.
Even if the matches were better than they were, it's the booking that just grinds you down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, ever since she debuted, the people wanted Sasha Banks to be successful. And she just hasn't been.
Yeah.
She's been the best thing on the show.
They're just not letting her win anything. You know?
That being said... Oreo has to make noise.
Oreo wants to play Squeaky Monster.
That being said, you know, putting over a strong champion, I have no problem with. You know, having Charlotte be a strong champion and winning,
mm-hmm.
Okay, fine. But yeah, the cumulative effect,
Sorry.
This was where I officially checked out, was the squeaky toy. No, this was the match that firmly pissed me off. Shane McMahon versus The Undertaker, Hell in a Cell. With control of Raw on the line,
yeah.
And if Undertaker loses, he has, according to Vince, no more matches at WrestleMania.
Mm-hmm.
This was the most highly anticipated match on the show.
Yeah.
It was by pretty much everybody.
Really?
Yeah.
I was not anticipating it. Well, I was anticipating things about it, but none of them were good.
Everyone was really hyped about this match. Shane McMahon came back to, like, a superhero's reaction.
I don't know why. Here's my feelings about Shane McMahon. He looks like the manager of a Best Buy.
Here's why they liked him so much. And actually, I really can't believe that young people even remember who he is. Because the last time he was on TV was a long time ago. But he has put on really great matches.
Has he?
Yeah. Against, like, Kurt Angle, Big Show Kane... You know, way better matches than you ever would have expected. The guy's fucking crazy. And that's another great thing about him is, you know, he's got this crazy man shtick and he's known for jumping off insanely tall things.
Mm.
But this was like 12 years ago. I'm sitting here wondering why he's getting such a huge reaction when they're putting him in a match with a really old guy and he's 46 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. He's got this reputation for jumping off absurdly high things. Let me tell you really briefly that when I was in high school as a freshman and sophomore, I did mainly comedy on a theater stage, you know, the high school theater stage. I did mainly pratfalls. One would call it buffoonery. Big shock, right? Pratfalls being just taking, you know, falling down really hard. I was taking back bumps on a hardwood floor. Not knowing that they were bumps, you know, not being like, I'm like a wrestler.
No.
But I was pretty much taking flat back bumps on hardwood. Here's the difference. I was 14 years old. I was fucking indestructible.
Yeah, you were made of rubber and bounciness at the time.
I'm in my 30s now. If I did that, I would shatter every fucking thing in my hip, spine, and neck.
Mm.
After one.
Yeah.
Okay, so Shane was doing crazy shit and hurting himself grievously back then. 12 years later, he's doing this shit.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm like, this was my prediction where I was like, Shane is going to lose this match not because he gets beat, because he's going to get legitimately hurt.
Yeah, that was my biggest fear for this match, was that one of the two was, or both were going to get really badly hurt, because I just knew they were going to do something crazy.
Yeah. And sure, I mean, it's a miracle that he wasn't hurt. Not worse than he was.
Yeah.
He went on Raw, he was walking like he dropped a soap. this is one of those matches where everyone thought I was crazy. I was like, you really don't want to see this match. And they're like, but it's Shane McMahon. It's The Undertaker. It's going to be great. I go, this is the kind of match you think you want to see until you actually see it. Kind of like Zack Ryder? No. Kind of. It kind of is. It's almost like Sting versus Triple H WrestleMania. Everyone was so freaking pumped to see that match. And I was like, there's like 100 years combined age in that ring.
Yeah.
It's not going to be good. And it was probably as good as it could have been.
Yeah.
Which is not good.
Not that good.
Yeah. And I hate being right in this case. I do.
Yeah, you'd rather it be a great match, but...
Yeah, I want to see a good match.
There's only so much you can get from...
Yeah.
People full of sand and dust.
Yeah. So, this match starts off in the cell, and it's not good. It's just a bunch of really slow plotting, punching and kicking. Yeah, and getting
very
thrown.
Slow.
Well, the thing is, they don't want to get Shane blown up. They don't want to get either one of them blown up. Mm-hmm. And Undertaker was looking tired.
Yeah.
The announcers are doing everything in their power to put over how tough Shane is. You know, like, he practices jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
You know, he's training with Hoist Gracie. Did Hoist Gracie teach him the sharpshooter? That's not a jiu-jitsu move, but
no. Whatever.
They're putting over, like, at every turn that Shane has a chance against this guy.
At no point did I feel like that was so.
I know I'm bringing up credibility in a show where a guy is wrestling...
He's wrestling a zombie man.
He's wrestling a wrestling zombie man. But you're looking at Shane McMahon going, this is stupid.
Yeah, it's like watching your dad in a bar fight or something.
Yeah, it's like, we have a guy who was going toe-to-toe with Brock Lesnar on the last pay-per-view.
Yeah.
And now he's getting rocked by Shane McMahon.
Yeah.
With his shitty fucking punches.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going, no, it's bullshit. He's a wrestling zombie man. He should not be, like, selling this much. Like, he's in the corner, like, covering up to Shane McMahon.
Shane McMahon.
It was bad.
Yeah.
And then Shane gets a pair of bolt cutters, cuts the cage open, and I knew right away what was going to happen. You know, somebody's going on top of the cage and jumping off.
Yeah.
And Shane. It was going to be Shane. So Shane beats the shit out of Taker with a monitor, who's laying there for like 5 minutes.
Yeah.
If he was that beat up, just pin him. Anyway, he looks up. He's like, oh, I'm gonna jump off this fucking cage. And right away, I'm like, don't do this.
Yeah.
Everyone was like, don't do this.
I was like, don't do this. I was afraid I was going to see him splattered all over the floor.
This is where I got mad. He goes up to the cage. He goes on top of the cage, which is much higher than it was when Mick Foley took his header off the cage to the table. I believe that cage was 16 feet tall. I believe the cage in this match was 20.
That's what they said.
More than 20. That is, he was going 25% faster when he hit the table. I did the math. 25% faster when he hit the table than Foley was. There was a crash pad underneath this table. That's the only reason he's alive.
Yeah.
That's it. People were telling me that you're being too hard on this. There was a crash pad. It was planned. Fuck you. Okay? This was stupid crazy. Not just like awesome stupid crazy. No, this was stupid.
Mm-hmm.
His kids were in the audience.
Yeah.
I don't care if there was a crash pad underneath this table. 20 feet up?
It was just too risky.
20 feet up? That table looks like this. Okay? Had he missed that table or hit it halfway, he's dead. He's crippled.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just go that far. He has to hit this table after working like 15 minutes with the Undertaker. You know, his legs are shaking.
Mm-hmm.
He's breathing hard. He can't maybe see too well. He might actually have a concussion. And you expect him to hit this little postage stamp of a table from 20 feet up? Miracle he did.
Yeah.
Fucking miracle. And even then, miracle he wasn't hurt.
Yeah.
Had he missed...
I was like this. Like, I couldn't even watch, barely.
Had he missed, crippled. Minimum.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Or at least something very badly broken.
And people are like, well, it went off without a hitch, so can't you be happy? Like, it worked? No! I can't be fucking happy about this. This was stupid.
It shouldn't have been done in the first place, I guess.
He could have been fucking killed. Okay? In front of his kids!
Yeah.
What the fuck? What the fuck? I'm so mad about this. It was insane when Foley did it.
Mm-hmm. And that wasn't even intentional, was it?
The first fall was. The second one where I went through the top of the cage, that was not planned.
Yeah.
But it was stupid when Foley did it. When I was shooting my nightmare review, I was taking front bumps off the top of a ladder. I didn't tell you about this, because it was fucking stupid.
Yeah.
I did three of those. That was from 5 feet up.
Into a pile of, like...
No, I had one pillow on the floor.
One? You idiot!
One.
What did you think that was gonna do?
Not much. And it didn't. 5 feet up. I did three of these. Stupid. I'm not saying do as I say. I'm not do as I do as I say, okay? Mm-hmm. Stupid. Which is why I didn't tell you I was doing it. 5 feet up. At my age. Not that I'm a fucking old man, but I'm in my 30s, okay? I could have broken my fucking hip. And by the way, telling you was actually a pretty dumb move. Had I broken my fucking hip? You were out of the house all day.
Yeah. You probably should have told me you were doing that. Or kept your phone nearby in case of emergency.
I couldn't have it on me. If I fell on my phone, I'd break it. Dumb. So dumb. And worse, it looked fake. You know, it was like, we're going to go jump off this cage because it's a really high cage and he wants to jump off it. Mm-hmm. Totally unnecessary. Served no point. Looked staged as hell because it was staged as hell. Mm-hmm. And then Undertaker wins the match anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he does this insane, nearly suicidal stunt. For no reason.
For no reason. He sacrifices himself for no reason.
Had he won the match, at least in character, and out, it would have served a purpose. He put his body on the line to win control of Raw because it meant that much to him.
Yeah.
And it paid off.
Mm-hmm.
No.
That's not what happened, though.
Shane jumped off his fucking cage, nearly killed himself, and lost anyway.
Yeah.
Pointless now. So mad.
Mm-hmm.
Can't get over it. I was so mad that, they did the Battle Royal, and Battle Royals are always shit.
Yeah.
I'm just sitting there, like, pacing. Just fuming. Mm-hmm. This entire time. And you've got this shitty fucking match going on that I can't even begin to care about under ideal circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck this. This is one of the worst matches I've ever seen. Now, from a wrestling standpoint, not good. And I cannot divorce my own personal feelings from this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, from my perspective, this was offensive. His kids were in the fucking audience. This could have turned out so badly, so easily.
Mm-hmm.
I think about Owen Hart, totally different circumstances, dying in that fucking ring, and we've got a 46-year-old man jumping 20 feet onto a tiny fucking table.
Yeah.
I'm going to stop going on about this. But if you want to know where I'm coming from, that's it. What did you think about this match? Maybe it didn't offend you as much as it did me. That's entirely likely.
I think everybody else just felt it was par for the course, but in my opinion, they're asking too much of people who don't have that much left to give.
I can't think of a single person on the roster I would be like, well, I'd rather have this guy do it. I wouldn't have Neville.
True. I wouldn't want anyone else to do it either.
I wouldn't have Neville do this. Yeah, and he's the one guy you'd probably want to do this. Fuck that. I care about Neville. I care about Shane McMahon.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want him to die. It turned out okay. Miracle.
Mm-hmm. But he still lost.
And he lost. Which was undone the next night on Raw.
Yeah. Damn it.
Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal, full of geeks, and Damien Sandow, who amazingly is still employed.
Yeah. And so is Fandango.
Fandango. Apparently. Both eliminated without ceremony. Actually, Fandango had more of a moment because everyone was like avoiding Shaquille O'Neal.
Yeah.
And the Big Show. But Fandango stayed behind and started dancing for no reason.
Yeah.
And they both murdered him.
Yes. I feel like all I'm doing is saying yes and agreeing with you, but...
Because I'm rambling.
Yeah.
If you would please go, I'm...
No. Our feelings are very similar on this show. There's not a lot we disagree with, it seems like.
I feel bad because I am just screaming now at this point. Shaq was in this match. Damien Sandow got eliminated to a chorus of boos, but the camera wasn't even on him.
Oh, yeah. You didn't even see it.
How much does that suck when you're... Okay, was Tyler Breeze in this match?
I think so, yeah.
God. How much does it suck when you're Tyler Breeze and you don't even rate to be in the Intercontinental Championship match? Zack fucking Ryder, who's not even on Raw. He's one of the fucking hype bros. Gets in this match. No, Tyler Breeze gets crammed in the Jobber Battle Royal.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, I called very few of the matches correctly. Weirdly enough, I called this match correctly.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know Baron Corbin was going to be in it. I was joking. And he won.
Yeah.
Not that that means anything.
No.
In fact, that does not bode well.
Yeah.
Given the previous winners.
Well, then the very next day on Raw, like...
He goes to a count-out with Dolph.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, he should have just kicked Dolph from pillar to post if you wanted to make him look strong. But no, it's like a 10-15-minute match where they're both trading blows pretty fairly.
He did kick Dolph's ass.
He did, but everyone kicks Dolph's ass.
You're learning. No, he did kick Dolph's ass, but... Yeah...
Not enough. He didn't kick his ass hard enough.
He cut the most generic heel promo. He's like, I'm a heel and I'm big. And I don't care if you boo me because I'm a heel. And heels don't care, so if you boo me because I'm a heel. Ah.
Yeah. It was pretty generic.
And I like Baron Corbin. The thing is, he's going to get so romogenized, you know. That also, Apollo Crews, he's going to suffer.
Oh, yeah. He's going to suffer on the mid-card.
He's really not a very good promo to begin with. And then they're going to do this shit where they're going to have Renee Young say, my guest at this time, Apollo Crews. Apollo, how do you feel about Kevin Owens kicking this guy's ass? And then he's going to do the same fucking promo every fucking guy does.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody's going to care.
Yeah.
Going to get heat for that one, too. But before you start with this, I direct you to the previous line of success from the NXT graduates. Not good.
No.
I hope for the best for Apollo Crews. Insanely talented, this guy.
Mm-hmm.
Although he squashed Tyler Breeze, who is also very talented, and showing up in a Jobber Battle Royal. Then the finale... Oh, I'm sorry. No, then The Rock came out with a flamethrower.
Yeah, which we thought was a t-shirt gun at first. And then fire came out of it, and we were very confused. Why did he have a flamethrower?
And why did Dean Ambrose not take the flamethrower? And then we realized why he should not have taken the flamethrower, because there are few nightmares in this earth and beyond more terrifying than the thought of a Brock Lesnar on fire.
Yeah. Chasing you. F5-ing you on fire.
Because you know that wouldn't kill him.
There's not enough to burn. It would just, like, hover above his skin.
It's going to be like the Terminator when the gas truck blows up.
Mm-hmm.
And they think the Terminator's dead. And then the Terminator comes out and it's just like his skeleton.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
It'd be flaming Brock Lesnar skeleton, like, come out and just fucking kill him.
Yeah.
And his skeleton's going to look like that tattoo on his back. Like,
yeah.
The horns
yeah,
and
it
shit.
Yeah, it's going to have the fangs and shit.
Yeah. And it's scary as he should have done it, actually. No, I mean... But yeah, I was like, you know, the chainsaw was probably a better move than the flamethrower. So The Rock comes out for no reason with a flamethrower. For no reason. And does he even talk about anything?
No.
He announces the building attendance record.
Yeah. He talks about the fact that he walked past the Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders.
Oh, and that this show is so awesome, everyone's going to go home and have sex.
Ew.
And have... babies are going to name after The Rock.
Gross.
Show was not that good. Really was not. Then the Wyatts come out for no reason.
Yeah.
Surround the ring. The least intimidating guy since the League of Nations.
Despite the fact that Bray Wyatt's now wearing, like, fakey human faces on his apron.
He had this just the cheesiest shit. He had rubber
masks on his apron.
This was another example of him looking like he pillaged Spirit Halloween.
Yeah.
The day after Halloween.
Like, are we meant to imply that you really skinned human faces and stuck them on your... Why are the police not tracking you down for your serial homicides?
Why are they paying the Wyatts if they're fucking crazy?
Yeah.
I don't know. But Bray comes out and he says, you represent success, Rock, and that's why I want to beat your ass.
Or something.
The Rock is not impressed.
No.
Nor should he be. He then proceeds to rip his pants off in one fluid motion. Thank God he had tights on underneath
Thank God. What if he forgot?
You'd see the people strudel then. But he demands a match. He doesn't care what kind.
Mm-hmm.
So Eric fucking Rowan, the Vintner, the hitman of the Wyatts, gets pinned in 7 seconds.
Six.
Shit. Good job. And so then the rest of the Wyatts start to swarm the ring and try to kick his ass. Rock pretty much clears house by himself. Then John Cena comes out to a chorus of boos.
Yeah, and John Cena sucks songs.
Yeah. The Rock and John Cena destroy the Wyatts utterly.
Mm-hmm.
Yet another example of a retired wrestler destroying your only, your established talent.
Yeah.
Trying to put them over. I guess it was the baby, the baby faces got cheered. They cleared house. But yeah, buried the Wyatts. You buried the league.
Yeah.
You buried the New Day. Even in victory, the league gets buried.
Mm-hmm.
This helps nobody. Yeah, it gets cheers from the audience. But could the Wyatts look like any bigger geeks?
No.
They could. Wow. If Zack Ryder had beat their asses.
Yeah.
But this was close.
Well, and meanwhile, the announcers were like, John Cena, what's he doing here? I know he shouldn't be here medically.
Honestly, he shouldn't. The guy's got a healing factor.
Yeah. He looked both slimmer and younger, so we think that we're right about the theory that they just clone a new one every time he gets injured.
Yeah,
so this is just the Cena clone. It's not quite done yet. They got to put it back in the oven.
Well, they ran out, I think, at one point, which is why this took like 3 months to make a new one.
Yeah. They didn't plan ahead and make several.
Yeah. Okay, then, this was the only match I was looking forward to, really, was the main event. Triple H versus Roman Reigns. Merely because I wanted to see how badly... To see if the crowd could actually kill Roman Reigns with their combined voices.
Yeah, they tried.
They tried. They could not. This started out with a really weird introduction by... the video package. The video package made Triple H look so much fucking cooler than Roman Reigns did.
Yeah.
They cut together this video package of, like, Triple H with an army of darkness.
Yeah.
Like, clown heads with, like, metal things riveted over their mouths.
Skull heads, yeah.
Like, a legion of skull head men and this apocalyptic wasteland and Triple H as this skull fucking face-wearing conqueror.
Mm-hmm.
And then Roman Reigns is just really boringly standing in the ring going, like, I'm the authority. I will win. And then, like, some highlight footage of him Superman punching Triple H. Meanwhile, Triple H is on, like, is riding down the plains of Samaria on a battle steed, killing fuckers with an axe.
Sitting on a throne of blood and bone.
You know, heavy metal music.
With his hot wife in leather.
With his hot wife, like, on the armrest, like, in a bikini. Which, I'm not exaggerating, she was sitting on a giant throne of stone, shaped like an iron cross, with a fucking skull helmet on, looking like General Kale from Willow.
Yeah. Which was pretty cool, actually.
It was cool! Roman Reigns, not that cool!
Roman Reigns got the most boring intro ever.
Yeah.
Like, it was just his normal video package, and then he walked in and he punched the ground, and then the graphics were, like, a second off.
Yeah. So and then there was a lot of pyro.
The ground didn't explode in time, even.
Yeah.
So it was just lame and made me feel sorry for Roman.
You know what they need to do to help Roman? And this is going to sound so simple and so stupid. Get him better music.
Yeah, get him better music.
He has the most boring music.
He could use a change. He needs a change.
Meanwhile, Triple H is coming out to fucking Motorhead.
Yeah.
This guy.
It doesn't compare, and
it actually
seems very lame.
It actually grinds your energy down because it's this slow plodding minor chord.
Yeah, it's almost like it's villain music.
Kind of.
It should be like the big slow stupid one, and he's not and he's not stupid.
I know.
He just has 3 moves. That's all.
But at every turn, then Stephanie comes out. Pure supervillain mode.
Mm-hmm.
Comes out and cuts this promo about how we're all pathetic and weak and how we'll bow to authority.
We need to be sheeple that they protect with their evil.
And somehow. The crowd is like, woo, we welcome you, our bitchy overlord. Really? There's one point, at one point, Chris Jericho on Raw comes out.
I liked her outfit, by the way. I would steal that outfit.
Oh, yeah. I would, too.
You'd look great in those heels.
Oh, thank you. Now, at one point in Raw, the announcers at the beginning of Raw, by the way, come right on camera and say, post-WrestleMania crowds are fucking crazy.
Yeah.
They're going to boo all the baby faces,
mm-hmm.
just so you know. Because they wanted to cushion the audience at home for why they fucking obliterate Roman Reigns.
Yeah.
But
well, like, how many times during WrestleMania, when he won, did they have to turn the crowd speakers off?
They muted the crowds.
Yeah.
They muted it. But let me finish on Raw here. AJ Styles is in the ring after losing. Chris Jericho comes out to wild cheers.
Mm-hmm.
He's a heel. So Jericho is trying his best to get people to boo him.
Yeah. And it's just not working.
Yeah. But he says something like, you know, you're an idiot. You know, Styles, you're an idiot, just like all these people here. You guys can all shut up, idiots. And the crowd, in response, chants, we are idiots.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. The crowd was trying to put themselves over like crazy. My favorite moment of which was when, during commercial break, somebody brought a beach ball out, and a security guy took it away, who apparently got bigger boos than Roman Reigns did.
For taking away beach ball?
This proceeded
you
to...
You bastard.
This resulted in a chant of, we want beach ball. Let's go, beach ball.
Beach ball sucks. Yeah.
Beach ball does not suck. Beach ball was the coolest thing on the fucking show, and I didn't even see beach ball. I would play... God damn it, that guy. Apparently there's a lot of beach balls, so... Beach ball does not suck. He's very popular. They should sell beach balls.
They should.
Anyway.
No.
So Roman Reigns comes out 100% booing, as far as anyone could tell on TV.
Yeah.
There were people cheering him, I have no doubt.
There were cheers from individual sections of ladies.
Kids, mainly kids.
It's mainly ladies.
Really?
Yeah.
You think so? Okay.
It's the ladies who think he's so sexy.
He has the dreamiest eyes.
He does have dreamy eyes.
But yeah, Triple H from the beginning. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Stephanie looked like Rita Repulsa.
Or Anti-Entity.
Yeah, or the guy from Willow. But yeah, I think somebody photoshopped an image of like Stephanie going, like, after 10,000 years, I'm free! So yeah, and okay. I thought this was going to be a good match. It was not.
No.
You know, believe it or not, Roman Reigns
can carry a match well.
Oh yeah, yeah, he always has. You know, and Roman Reigns, when carried, can put on a really good match.
Mm-hmm.
I reference you to the Brock Lesnar fight at last year's WrestleMania. Good match, really good match.
Mm-hmm.
So I had really high expectations for this one.
So did I.
This was not a good match.
No,
this was boring as shit.
It was boring as all get out.
And this wasn't because I was in a bad mood from the Undertaker match. This was a bad match.
Yeah. Like, I don't know what happened, but it's like Triple H was like, I'll let him stand on his own, and he failed at it.
Triple H was doing a lot of stuff that was very un-Triple H. He was doing a lot of submissions. Like, he was doing, like, an arm breaker.
Yeah.
Doing a lot of arm bars.
Yeah.
Which is Chris Jericho's gimmick, by the way. He's the man of 1,004 holds. A WCW thing.
Maybe somebody was just feeling off tonight or that night or something.
I don't know, but it was just a lot of, like the Shane match, just a lot of clubbering.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of just punching around.
Yeah, just two big guys punching each other.
Roman Reigns has a limited enough moveset, mostly consisting of punching and kicking people in the face.
Yeah.
You have never been impressed with this man. Nor do I blame you.
No.
This was just a really boring match.
Yeah.
This.
And the finish was just something awful.
The finish was
abrupt and weird.
It was just, yeah, it was pretty much what I expected.
I was expecting more. Like, it almost seemed like they didn't, like, they got cut for time or something.
You know what it was? Is it was very un-WrestleMania, and yeah. I don't know if this is a good thing or bad thing. WrestleMania matches have a tendency to have a thing where people kick out of their finishers.
Yeah, like, that was
twice, three times.
There was not much of that.
You know,
weird.
So yeah, like I don't know if anyone kicked. Did Roman Reigns kick out of a pedigree?
I don't know. Probably. If he ever got it. I don't know if he ever got one in.
But
he
yeah,
tried, but I don't remember if he got one in.
I don't think anybody really thought it was going to be the finish. that was why it was kind of anticlimactic. Mm-hmm. Was he just kind of Triple H goes for a sledgehammer, apparently not caring if he gets disqualified.
Yeah.
There were like two other occasions where Stephanie blatantly pulls the ref out of the ring, not a disqualification.
Yeah.
Now, I know that it's WrestleMania, and in character, the referee was like, I can't end this match on a DQ. But when the sledgehammer enters the ring, okay, he actually tries to use the sledgehammer, Roman Reigns ducks and spears him, 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
Had he hit him with the sledgehammer, disqualification.
Yeah.
So, I think everyone thought he was just going to kick out of the spear.
I thought so.
You know, usually in these matches, people kick out of like 2 or 3 finishes. Whether or not that's a good thing or a bad thing, whatever, but it was very unexpected.
Yeah, it just, it made the end feel like it came out of nowhere.
Which could be a good thing done right, you know, like he, like an RKO, he hits it out of nowhere.
If it was surprising that Roman was going to win and it came out of nowhere, maybe.
Nobody was surprised by this.
We all knew he was going to win it.
That was a big problem with the show, was after Roadblock, when they had the chance to put Dean Ambrose in this match, nobody really thought they would. Mm-hmm. They were really hoping they would, mm-hmm. against foolish hope. But as soon as Ambrose lost that match, the sense of inevitability surrounding this match was just a tar pit.
Yeah.
You know, as soon as this match started, everyone knew
what
was going to happen.
We've known what was going to happen for the weeks leading up.
Now, they've been booking the storyline for over a year. This is how the feud is supposed to end.
Yeah.
Is the good guy wins, triumphs over the authority, and expels them from, you know, the WWE. Not that that happens.
No.
But
so why does it feel so shitty?
Because nobody likes Roman Reigns.
Yeah.
Had this been Daniel Bryan, and actually has been Daniel Bryan, mm-hmm. was wildly successful.
Yeah.
When Daniel Bryan finally won that match, everyone loved it. He overcame all the odds, won 2 matches in one night, mm-hmm. beat all the odds, won, defeated the authority. They wanted to replicate that, I can only assume, in this case. And they hated it because they're pushing Roman Reigns down our throats.
Yeah.
And I do not want Roman Reigns pushed in my throat.
You want Roman Reigns gently in your throat.
Whatever. Nobody, people can tell when they're being manipulated.
Yeah. Despite the cheers of the crowd, we're not idiots. We know that you're making Roman Reigns the guy, and we don't want him to be the guy because he's not that entertaining.
And the reason he's getting so thunderfucked by boos is they've learned nothing from last year.
Yeah.
The history has repeated itself from last year. After the Rumble, this has been a pattern, really, mm-hmm. like being tone deaf at the Royal Rumble. Mm-hmm. The last year Roman Reigns is in the title picture, everybody booed him. Mm-hmm. This year, same thing.
Yeah.
Everybody booed him. And people even cared less because at least Brock Lesnar was in that main event, mm-hmm. and people liked him. Mm-hmm. They cheered by Triple H by default.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
They were like, it really is the anyone but you, Roman, thing. Yeah. They're like, we will accept the authority over your, you know, he's the chosen one, and he's obviously the chosen one.
Yeah.
And
But we didn't choose him, so we don't want him.
And I guess I'm telling you guys what you already know, but it seems like at every turn, it's not that they're surprised, because it's like they've prepared for the thunderous booing that he gets.
That's true.
They know it's going to happen, it seems like.
But they keep pushing down this path anyway.
And they don't care. Mm-hmm. Because I can only think
we're just going to like get tired and give up and accept him or something.
I can only think that Vince's, or Kevin Dunn or whatever it is, or whoever's behind it, only thinks that we'll grow to love him. You know, eventually we'll just get over it. Mm-hmm. It's been 2 years, Holmes.
Yeah.
We're not getting over it. No. We don't like him. You know,
we tried. Everybody tried. I mean, maybe if you'd had him, like, winning or something, that might have helped.
It's not even that. It's just, he's not even that.
Yeah. He just doesn't have what we're looking for, and I'm not sure what it is we're looking for so much, but
we're just looking for someone we picked.
Yeah.
You know, Daniel Bryan had that factor where we liked him, mm-hmm. and they resisted that as long as they could.
Yeah.
You know, they did everything in their power to bury that fucker.
They did.
And, well, you don't even know.
I missed years of it.
You know, you missed when he was brought up from NXT before NXT is what it is now.
Yeah.
he was the only guy on the NXT show who emerged from that show with no victories.
Wow.
There were like they all had like 13 matches or something like that. He was the only one who went winless. They buried him that deep. Mm-hmm. For a year plus, they had Michael Cole loudly screaming, burying this guy about how much he's a geek, about how girls don't like him, about how much he sucks, mm-hmm. you know. Really, he's a nerd, they'd say. Mm-hmm. You know, nobody likes this guy because he's at every turn, it was like Vince, he was like just sock puppet for Vince, you know, doing this thing. That's all I got is on, and then on Raw, at the end of WrestleMania, you know, boo, everyone's booing this guy. They basically mute the crowd mics.
Yeah.
Like, cut them entirely.
You could tell that it was just thunderous boos, though.
And the commentators are trying their best to sound like this is the most epic victory ever. You know, triumph for good. The authority's been banished. Boo! You know.
Except for, like, that one lady in the front who was so happy.
Oh, that lady was so happy. She was... Mm-hmm. You know, on Raw, they managed to undo everything that Shane McMahon match was supposed to do. Like, for no reason, Vince comes out gloating about how Shane got beat. Mm-hmm. And then Shane McMahon comes out and, you know, he shakes Vince's hand. He's like, you know, you beat me fair and square. I just want to thank this crowd. You know, you made all this possible. You drove me to do this crazy shit. It didn't work, but thank you, crowd. You know, thank you, WWE Universe. And then, for no reason, Vince gets mad and starts rambling about, nobody upstages me. You know what? You want to run Raw? God damn it. Go ahead and do it.
Yeah.
And then he runs to his limo, like, fuck this shit, I'm going home.
Yeah.
Now, apparently it was only for one night, but what the fuck was the point?
Yeah, what was the match even for if he was just going to give it to him anyway?
The whole point of this was...
Oreo.
Was to get Shane out of his life and get this lockbox. Mm-hmm. Which apparently has been gotten. But yeah, no, he's like, you know what? Fine. You can have a match. You can run Raw. Just, I was so mad. Let's compare this now to one of the matches of the year, Sami Zayn versus Shinsuke Nakamura. Mm-hmm. Fucking amazing
match.
That
was a great match.
I knew as soon as that happened, from the entrance alone, that nothing on WrestleMania was going to be as good as this.
Yeah.
I had more fun during that entrance than at anything at any point during WrestleMania. Mm-hmm. That was an amazing match.
Yeah.
They were all good matches. Even the one that I didn't really like as much was the Finn Balor Samoa Joe thing, which they kept stopping that match over and over because Joe got busted open.
Yeah.
I just thought they handled it.
I didn't see that one.
I thought they handled it poorly by having it. They stopped and started like six times.
Oh, sure.
Crowd did not like this. Nor did I. I thought they should have just canceled the match. Not canceled, but suspended it for 5 minutes.
Yeah.
To get the cut closed up. It would not have gone over well.
But it would have worked better than stopping it every 5 minutes.
No, every like 20 seconds. Yeah. You know? Because they didn't close the cut properly. They were just taking a towel and like wiping his face off. Ugh. That did not close the cut.
No.
They're lucky it actually did manage to close. Mm-hmm. Kind of on its own. But... they should have just taken 5 minutes, like, you know, call a doctor stoppage, get the cut closed up, come back, fight, you know, run a video package, come back, finish the match. Mm-hmm. That said, once things calmed down in terms of the cut, it was a great match. It was awesome. I was initially kind of shitting on it because of the doctor stoppages, but once it got going, it was great. Mm-hmm. The Bailey Asuka match, you know, people didn't like how that one turned out necessarily. But it was still a great match. Mm-hmm. It was really almost depressing. This is the second time I've said that after a takeover show.
Yeah.
It was honestly depressing having watched such a great show, knowing that in 2 days, the Raw brand is going to put on a pile of shit.
Yeah.
And sure enough, there you go.
Yeah, you were right. But... that's why I say we should stop watching NXT before big events.
See, you got it backwards. But like, you know, you want to save it for after.
Save it for after, and then you feel better.
Just so I'm not dreading the show?
Yeah. Like, you save NXT as a reward for ourselves or something.
But I don't want to. I want to see NXT now.
I know. Okay. But it's like having your dessert first. There's nothing to look forward to then.
Now we're comparing Raw to eating our vegetables.
Yeah, it kind of is.
That's all I've got to say, babe. Do you have any other insight into this show?
No, not really.
Seriously, because I've cut you off at every turn. I feel bad.
That's fine. I didn't have a lot to say that disagreed with you. I agreed with everything just about. And, yeah, there were a lot of, like, I kept getting up during Raw and leaving the room because I couldn't stand it anymore.
You hated Zack Ryder good.
I hated Zack Ryder, and I hated that he then lost immediately.
Yeah.
Like, if you're going to give it to him for at least a week, you know?
But he deserved it, babe.
It's like they just want to spite the fans now. It's like they're doing things just because they hate us.
I want to disagree with you, but in some cases it's hard to argue. Yeah, especially with Roman Reigns. It's like, God damn it, you will like this man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't know, the only positive I had was it was nice to see Cesaro come back.
Cesaro came back on Raw.
But
Raw was actually really good.
And then, you know, people from NXT came up, but I dread seeing people from NXT come up now because they get ruined.
Yeah.
They're just going to be sitting on the mid card with nothing to do in pointless feuds that seem really stupid.
Okay, well, you say that, AJ Styles did win the number one contenders match. So, as much as I was complaining that they weren't doing anything with AJ Styles, he is in the number one contenders match.
That's true. I was glad that he won that.
Downside, Roman Reigns is probably going to kill him.
Yeah. In a match that, for some reason, sucks, even though AJ Styles is good.
But it's easy to get excited, and it's a good thing to be excited, because despite my complaints early on about Raw, a lot of good things happened. Mainly all of them NXT debuts.
Yeah.
You know?
I dread them. Like, it's like they're taking away from NXT and just doing nothing with it.
Well, I'm going to hold out hope for this one, because there was a lot of really... I think they like Enzo and Cass, who are called up. Apparently they're bringing the Vaudevillains up.
Oh, are they? That's good for them.
By the way, Simon Gotch is my boy. Shout out to Simon Gotch.
They're my favorite tag team. So
really?
Yeah. I would really like to see them succeed.
Yeah. I want to see all of them succeed.
Yeah.
Enzo and Cass were hugely popular.
Were they?
Oh, yeah.
That's
big time.
Good.
Everyone knew the chant. Enzo skewered them in his promo, you know, and the charisma those two teams had right off the bat, like, he was making fun of D-Von's lazy eye.
D-Von
reacted, you know, how dare you? And, you know, Bubba had to hold him back, and, you know, they should have made fun of Mama Dudley. Just the reactions were great. And the Dudleys are acting like really good heels. I really dig the hell out of it.
Come up.
Who else got brought up? I think they wanted Bayley when they had the women's championship match, belt presentation ceremony.
Yeah.
They were chanting for Bayley. She wasn't there.
No. Bring up Bayley, for God's sake.
No, don't do that.
Well, they'll ruin her, but I feel like she's been left behind by everyone else, and it's not fair. And it's only because she's not modeled pretty like everybody else.
I don't think that's why.
I feel like that's why.
I want to see her long enough to have a rematch with Asuka, at least.
Yeah, well, I do want to see that.
But there was a lot of really cool debuts going on. Baron Corbin's been called up. I like Baron Corbin. I didn't like him at first.
I like him better now.
I've turned the corner on the guy.
Yeah.
He's doing really well. Apollo Crews got brought up.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why they call him Apollo Crews. Uha Nation's a much better name.
That is a cooler name.
Raw made me pretty optimistic, all things considered.
I feel like I'm getting so jaded.
You're getting burned out.
Yeah.
Because we've watched a lot of wrestling lately.
Yeah.
Oreo is getting impatient, and I think that's as good a cue as any to end this, because I'm just rambling on, as I'm wont to do. Any final words for our lovely audience?
I've got that. I hope I'm wrong about them screwing up everyone they brought from NXT, but we'll see.
All right. So thank you for watching, everybody. Sorry it took so long to get this one done, but had a lot of thoughts, a lot of rage to process.
A lot of rage to process, yeah.
And I was
in
mourning.
It's like digesting meat. It takes a while.
Yeah. I was in mourning for poor Zach. Woo, woo, woo. You blew it. Ha! That's all I got. I should bring Pappy Ryder up.
I know, right?
He was really good. Had big guns, man.